Thanks, Stefan. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It's a big pleasure and honor for me to be in front of you today and at the start of this delivery ceremony for our first A350 XWB to Qatar Airways. I remember 7 years ago I was attending the delivery ceremony of the SQA, and at the time we were very much in front of our long sheet of paper still. And I was saying to myself, what a journey to get there. The journey is now done, and here we are. And here we are, and at the start, a short update on the program. Kiran will then give you an update on the product itself. But my purpose is really to summarize how we get there the last 2 years, and how we are going to go to the next step. So that's did we certify this aircraft? If this aircraft can be delivered, it's obviously because it's been certified. It can fly safely with our customers, with passengers. And this is the first thing. Then I will give you an update on our industrial journey and how we have focused on the maturity, so that we don't just deliver an aircraft, which is the first aircraft, but we deliver a mature aircraft, which is really ready to deliver to our customer the benefits he wants to have, and fly regularly and safely with his customers. And then finally, the Dash 1000, where we are. On the first part, certification was really a challenge. We in 2012 we committed that, I remember at the FAL inauguration in October 2012, we set to ourselves the goal we will deliver before the end of 2014 the first customer aircraft. And this of course needed to go through the whole flight test, FAL flight test certification journey. The certification itself, I think we can be very proud of what's been achieved. It's certifying a brand new aircraft at that time in just 14, 15 months after the start of the flight test period was really something that we never achieved before, or at least not in the recent times. It's the number of documents that were to be delivered to us, to our authorities, the number of testing on ground and in flight was really impressive, and all our suppliers and certainly Rolls-Royce, who are today with us, have been under very high pressure to be there, as well as our authorities, who have been working with us very closely until the very end. And we achieved their certification on the 30th of September, and it was really a big relief for all our teams, starting from there when we could think of our next step, which was to get the FAA approval after the EASA approval in Europe, getting the FAA approval, and finally also getting the certification for our first customer configuration aircraft. We had a number of modification to certify, and this was achieved as well in November. So all these efforts coming together at the right time as planned 2 years ago was for us a big demonstration that when we engage teams in Airbus, and when we have set and put in place all the foundations to get this aircraft ready to for certification, then it happens. Nevertheless, it didn't go without having to innovate during this process. First, it was about having an accurate planning. You can see here on the left hand side, you can see here the plan that we had set to ourselves, which is the dotted red line, which represent the number of flight hours that we thought were necessary to deliver all the results that are needed for certification coming from the flight test. And you can see the blue line, which is what we have actually achieved. And this shows that from the beginning, we've been constantly ahead of plan. And this allowed ourselves to mitigate all the small issues, because I very often ask, you must have had some issues. Yes, for sure, we have had some small issues, but being ahead of the plan always enabled us to mitigate those issues in the time and to get all the small fixes that we needed to have without impacting our plan. And you can also see how it compares to what had been achieved before the A3T. It was also a good journey for the certification path, but we were almost and always constantly ahead of what had been achieved. So the reason for that, first, the five aircraft that testing needed to have were all delivered on time and were delivered at the level of maturity, which enabled the flight test team to run the flight test program without any deviation. The second thing, we had some innovation. We have very solid sticks in the ground to pave the way to certification, and we have innovated, for instance, using this climatic chamber in the United States that enabled us to have a very fixed plan to get to this hot and high altitude testing and this sort of thing. So in terms of means, we have innovated. We had also planned a long time before to have the first cabin-equipped aircraft early in the programs, and we could have it as early as February this year, and then this enabled us to get the cabin maturity achieved to enable our early long flights beginning of June. And finally, we have put, since the beginning, a lot of efforts on reliability. I come back on that. The last ingredient of our success was the flight test execution itself. Our flight test team have done a great job, a wonderful job in planning and executing all these flight test programs. And the culminating event of this flight test program was the road proving. The road proving was an exercise that started at the end of July until the middle of August. And during this exercise, we had planned four big trips around the world, 26 flights in total, more than 80,000 nautical miles flown by the aircraft. I would say 100% operational reliability from a flight test point of view. All tests departed on time, and this has enabled this aircraft to gather a very strong image among all the customers that we visited during this journey, and all the crews that had the opportunity to fly the aircraft with us. One of the noticeable features of this aircraft is its silence. From the outside, inside as well, you will see that today. But from the outside, it's really a big achievement that we have beaten our target for noise at departure and arrival, where we are certified at UC05, which will be a big asset for our customers. And I think that our first customer will very soon use this asset to have test in London in the very beginning of the year. So that achievement has been noticeable, and there are sometimes some drawbacks. We flew the five aircraft that you saw on the first chart. At the start of my presentation, we flew them over Toulouse on the 29th of September, and nobody noticed, because they were too quiet. So sometimes be too good is not good from marketing point of view. ETOPS. ETOPS, we just after the route proving, we started the final ETOPS demonstration. We had eight flights with 7 hours running on one engine only. And this, together with the fact that we had that the authorities flying with us during the whole route proving and all the flight test program in general, we have gained a lot of confidence with our authorities by having them closely integrated in our team. And this is probably one of the factors that has enabled us to get quickly an ETOPS certification to a level that had been never achieved before at EIS from EASA. So now, from a technical point of view, our first customers, and we have all the certificates that enable us to deliver today this LSN 6 aircraft to Qatar Airways. So now, I also remember on the SV80, after the first delivery, we had to wait a little bit until we had the second and the third, etc. So this is something that we had learned our lessons about, and certainly we have proceeded differently. This is a curve that I've shown several times, and until now, we'll say more or less, yes, there are a couple of conditions for having a successful production runway. One of them was to certify on time. And to certify on time is two things. One is to avoid to have too much backlog in the final assembly line or the pre-final assembly line. Because you're in the certification, you are sure of one thing. There will be a few things to modify because you will always have some input from the flight test. There are limits to what you can simulate, and even if in this program we have passed beyond those limits most of the time, we still have to learn the aircraft in flight. So having the aircraft certified means stable design. The other important aspect is to monitor the number of aircraft and custom aircraft we have at the time of certification. Not too much and enough to make sure that the production can then follow on. And today we have not only all the Qatar Airways aircraft that we will deliver in 2015, but we have also the aircraft for our second operator, Vietnam Airlines, delivered in 2015, and we have also started the third operator aircraft in the final assembly line with Finnair. So we have today 13 aircraft in the final assembly line, and this is roughly what we were targeting at this point in time. And now we can lose the dose of war in a way. We can accelerate, and we have already accelerated in the pre-final assembly line, and we are going to accelerate strongly in the final assembly line in the beginning of next year. We will be starting the Red 3 at the beginning of next year, and then it will take us to a much higher number of deliveries in the coming years. So that's, I think, a good start in the industrial journey. It was prepared, and I'm glad that achieving just the certification at the first delivery on time enables us to think positively and with confidence about the next step. So now this aircraft will be flying with Qatar Airways, will be flying passengers between Doha and Frankfurt on the 15th of January. So things will go very fast. I'm sure our customer will be able to explain what is planning in the coming days, but it will be a very tense activity. Again, this aircraft is going to fly very soon and at a very high pace. Therefore, we always focused. We knew this was going to be the case, and we always focused delivering a mature aircraft. I will just mention two things that we've done differently on this program. First, it was about the airline office. Since almost 4 years now, we have had six customers working with us closely with our design office, first, with our flight test team, secondly. And this has provided us a lot of feedbacks, early feedbacks that we could take into account in our means in our way we mature this aircraft. And this is, I think, going to deliver a lot, and I will show you a couple of examples of things that we've done with this airline office support in the last weeks. The second thing was more in terms of process. We have, during the flight test campaign, we have really set
ourselves a goal of behaving like an airline. We've called ourselves Airline One. Airline One, we have 5 test aircraft, and we have really operated them like flight test aircraft, but also like customer aircraft in a way. And every single flight has been analyzed from a customer point of view. A flight test team, a test pilot, would always find the means to fly an aircraft, even if it has small dispatch messages. But we didn't think it was good enough, and therefore every single flight has been analyzed, scrutinized by people looking at it like an airline would do. And that by doing this, we could not only make a big library of things that our customer would not like, but we could, more importantly, train ourselves to having a higher level of reactivity in front of those issues. Most of the time, we could fix them during the flight test campaign itself. Means we have now a very high level of reliability. And I was when we were flying this aircraft, this MSM-6 aircraft for Qatar Airways last week, it was really encouraging to have this very high level of maturity, which results in a blank sheet in terms of dispatch messages and a very good post-flight reports. Means we are confident that with what we've done with both with the airline office and behaving like an airline during the flight test program, there will be a very good level of maturity at the start, but also for us a very high level of reactivity in front of the remaining issues that we might discover during the flight test program. And just to give you a couple of examples, we've run a lot of scenarios, operational scenarios, with the support of our airline office people. And we have, for instance, exercised the aircraft in operational turnaround cycles. We have also trained crews, but also other airline representatives to the biggest maintenance operations. We've dedicated 2 flight test aircraft to training our future operators on the maintenance tasks. And this is the first thing, the first time we do this kind of thing. And this will bring us to a very high level of operability at the start of operations with Qatar Airways. So the last things I wanted to show you is a short update on the Dash 1000 program. The Dash 1000 program timeline is unchanged. I believe we have an optimum spacing between the 900 and the Dash 1000. The 3 years that we have, 2014, 2017, 3 years from EIS to EIS, means that we could insert additional technologies. We could take full benefit of the tests that we've done on the 900. We could take all the lessons of the design cycle and training our people, maturing our tools and processes. Having the same industrial setup will also be a big asset for the Dash 1000, and also finally having the same suppliers, the same engine manufacturers, the same suppliers, the same partners all the way through, with very little exceptions, is a big asset for the Dash 1000. And when you put all that together, it explains that we are keeping on track on this program since the beginning. And now we have already reached the maturity level that enables to start the qualification phase with a good confidence. Our goal is to have in 2016 the first flight, to have in 2017 the IS. This is no change. And at the beginning of 2016, we will we will start the final assembly line of the first -1000, which has already under 69 orders in the portfolio. And if you want to see a couple of pictures, the -1000 has already entered our factory since the summer. We have already made the wing covers, the Trent XWB engine at 97k pounds of thrust, run already for the first time on 12th of July this year. The manufacturer of the main landing gear with the change from the -900 has already manufactured the first gears. And you can see here, it was in September, the machining of the first gears. And so this is all coming together, and in a couple of months we will start assembling sections, and after the summer equipping sections in our pre-final assembly line. So the -1000, having the benefit of the 900, is not only a highly efficient aircraft which takes full benefit of the technology, but is also a low-risk aircraft from an experience and from suppliers' point of view and from a timing point of view. So that's what I wanted to the first SU-50 is going to start operations in on the 15th of January from Doha to Frankfurt. It's a big change in the program life. Until now we were very much in the development program. Now we start our real serial program phase. We will adapt our organization, make sure that we take all the benefits of our serial program organization. And on top of what we have already done to prepare the ramp-up, the production ramp-up, I believe we have a good way ahead. And for the -1000, continuing to learn and to apply the lessons of the 900, like we did on the 900 from the past program, should give you a safe journey. And I'm sure I will have other opportunity to brief you about this journey. Thank you very much, and enjoy the day. Enjoy the day with us. Everything is with us, the aircraft, the sun, and you. So thank you for being with us and having perhaps compromise your relationship with your family, but promised we will let you go at the end of the day.
Thank you, Didier.